gostaríamos de convidar.
And now we would like to invite
o ex-ministro,
the former minister, Antônio Cabreira, Mano Filho, for our steering committee,
para iniciarmos a mesa redonda,
to start the round table.
Gostaríamos de lembrar.
We would like to remind you
que logo após a mesa redonda,
that after the round table, we have the Q&A session. You please require a form, you write down your question. And we will invite the economist Mansueto de Almeida.
Aproveitamos para lembrar os nossos alunos que após
please, students, after the round table, after the Q&A,
para que a frequência seja
sign your attendance.
Momento,
and at this moment, the moderator of the works, Dr. Antônio Cabreira Filho.
Boa noite a todos.
Good evening.
Nós vamos dar início
we are going to start our round table.
And
according to our schedule, the microphone is Dr. Mansueto's, and he has 20 minutes, so he can manifest about our public expenditure. Good evening. It's a great honor being here. I was a professor here at university in 1993-94. After a long time being here again, I have good memories. I will highlight some important points after the brilliant lecture that we had here. And it's really important this to Brazil. And I will connect this to the public expenditure. The first point. Showing why Brazil is so low in this economic freedom rate. Brazil is an emerging country. Brazil is a country that 2-3 years ago had a per capita
próxima de 11 mil dólares, que agora caiu para 7.500 dólares. Um país no qual, apesar de ser um país de renda média, nós temos uma estrutura de gasto público que chega a ser maior do que a média dos países desenvolvidos. A média dos países ricos tem um gasto público em torno de 39% do PIB. O Brasil teve um gasto público no ano passado de 43% do PIB.
Certo.
Isso, sem dúvida, nos torna um país
que,
até um certo ponto único, porque é um país em desenvolvimento com gasto público.
A developing country with a very high expenditure and the taxes are really high. The taxes in Brazil is about 33-34% of the GDP. And although this country has a tax so elevated, the public expenditure with investment in all the public sector in Brazil invests around 3% of GDP. So we have the taxes of 33-34% of GDP and public investment 33% of GDP. In the beginning of 1990, the taxes were about similar to the emerging countries. In the beginning of 1990, it was 25% GDP. How can this country increase the taxes so much, increasing the taxes almost in 10 points of GDP? The investment dropped, and today we have a tax, a fiscal crisis of 10% of the GDP. A country that has a nominal deficit near 10% of GDP is something that is not normal. This just happened in countries that are with a banking crisis or countries that are experiencing war. 2 years in a row, dropping the GDP 4% a year, this just happens in a country in a banking crisis or during war.
O Brasil não está em guerra, está com 2 anos de queda consecutiva do PIB, que no acumulado será próximo de 9%. Por quê? Entre outros motivos, porque o governo achava que esse governo tinha condições
the ability to promote this development and decide where the entrepreneur would invest. And this was really hard in the 1960s, in the 1970s, in the production chain. They were generally in the same country. In the modern economy, the production chains, they are fragmented. And it's really hard a country to have an incentive policies and take this to more competitiveness and industry growth. Today, what is called industry is really hard because part of what's called industry is services. When we produce an airplane turbine, we do not sell an airplane turbine. You sell hours of flight, hours of service. This is really complex. For a businessman, it's really complex. For the government, it's even more complex. But this government tried different ways to incentivize different sectors and companies, and at the end, took us to an economy that will have a drop of per capita GDP, 10% in 3-year time, that is not normal at all, and we take the risk of have one more lost decade. According to the World Economic Outlook disclosed 3 weeks ago, per capita GDP in Brazil in 2021 will be lower than the same index in 2011. It's a lost decade. In addition to that, we have a serious taxes crisis. I talked about the nominal debt in 10. If we see the interest, we have a primary debt in 12 months, 140 billion reais, something 2.2 GDP. The thing is, if we observe ahead, we can say that the trend of this fiscal hole is to decrease or getting more severe. It's getting more and more severe if we do not do anything. Why? Because today in Brazil, all the state governments experience a serious crisis. The state government, by the end of this year, will not pay their suppliers and their payroll. So you can ask me, but it's just the governor, just the governors, they reduce their expenditure, right? But we as society, in a reasonable way, we decided that the governors do not have instruments for that. What do I mean? 60-70% of an overhead in a state government is the payroll, active and inactive payroll. Is there an instrument that the government can use to reduce their payroll in a year or 2 years? The answer is no. Why? Because public worker in Brazil, they have stability 10 years. After 10 years, they have the tenure. They simply cannot be fired anymore, unless because of serious wrongdoing. The second, those employees that are not stable, the governor could fire them. But this is really hard, because imagine a state that the governor has one worker in agricultural secretariat with a tenure he does not need, and 300 workers in the health area, public security he hired in the last 3 years because he needs them. Those 300 workers in the health and public security, they do not have tenure. In order to fire a stable employee, he needs to fire 300 non-stable employees. He cannot do it. The 300 that are not stable, he needs them. And part of the stabilized ones, he does not need because he cannot fire. Because if he fires them, they have to fire the 300. This is legislation. In some cases, the fiscal responsibility law, if the government has a lack of balance, the state government, they can reduce the hours of working and the wages. But this rule, the government cannot use because it's not constitutional and it's not enforced. So, at the end of the day, put yourself in a governor's shoes. He spends 70% of 80% everything he collects and spends in a payroll. How can he solve this situation? He cannot solve it. He simply does not solve it. And we don't want to break the stability of public workers. So the fiscal crisis in the states will not be solved in 1, 2, 3 years. It will take 5 to more years to solve the state problem. The federal government, the problem is different. Brazil, as I said, is an emerging country, but we created, based on our decision as society, a network of welfare state political and social that is similar to a developed country with one abnormality. When we get Brazil expenditures 1991 up to 2015, last year, and we observe the end of the presidential term, it's clear, the data shows it clear, that non-president in Brazil from 91 up to today, when they left the presidency, when they left Brasilia, none of them could reduce the expenditure. All the presidents in Brazil since the 90s up to today, when they leave the government, they leave it behind a higher expenditure. So our growth in expenditure is based on the structure. In addition to this, all the countries in the world that spends a lot in social, in the Scandinavia, some European countries like Germany, France, Italy, these countries that spends a lot in the social work, consequently they have elevated taxes. But in Brazil, the countries spend a lot in the social work, they do not have resources to do what we have, sectorial policies. In some cases, they call industrial policies. Brazil, 7 years ago, for my surprise, decided to do both things, keep on the social policy, expanding the social programs, and at the same time, very actively in sectorial policies, in the ratio way above of the US and other countries did. Exactly. What are the figures? In Brasil, we have the government, national treasury, and we have public banks. In other countries, different countries do not have public banks. In Brazil, we have a public bank, that is Caixa Econômica Federal, and a private public bank, but with the sector public, there is a trade bank, Banco do Brasil, and a 100% bank, Caixa Econômico, that is BNDES. This BNDES bank is able to lend money 7 years ago, 90 billions a year. Today, just 130 billion with no borrow from the treasury. BNDES, 7 years ago, without the government help, was higher than the World Bank and the Inter-American Bank together. The World Bank, I believe you have heard about the World Bank. The World Bank works with different countries. A bank in Brazil, a public bank, was lending money in the 6 or 7 years more than the World Bank and Inter-American Bank together. How could they do it? Because the government said, well, I'm going to increase the debt a little. I can issue debt. I'll sell these bonds. I get this money and lend to the public bank. How much was this increase? How much the national treasury lent to the public banks in Brazil at the end of 2007? 14 billion reais, 0.4% of GDP. How much they lent to the public bank in Brazil today? A little bit more. It was 14 billion in 2007. Today, 470 billion reais, 9.8% of the GDP. And this brutal increase of 10 points in GDP by the government sending money to public banks for investments caused a massive distortions because the government trying to have a highway or airport concession or a hydropower plant and try to control the price, the return on investment rate, as we do not have any crazy businessmen for our work with a return rate very low, the government said, I'm going to control your tariff, but in exchange, I'll give you 9% of your capital with a BNDES loan that is subsidized. But BNDES did not have the money, so the government increased the debt and sent money to the BNDES to finance 90% of the cost of construction work that could be private, subsidize this cost to lower the tariff. But the money does not grow, increase. There's no free lunch. When the government had debt, they were creating a trap. What kind of trap? A government that increased the debts, they have to collect more taxes. So we were paying paying for that because the framework, the legal framework was not well performed. The government did this for 7 years and a lot of people applauded, a lot of businessmen applauded that. I saw businessmen, friends of mine, going to the TV to defend the legal framework to reduce the energy price. That was a disaster. Reducing the energy price in 18% in a year, increasing 50% the energy price the next year. And the system, the energy system to generate and distribution, they bankrupt. I saw people applauding the gasoline price did not raise when it should have. And this caused a whole financial imbalance at Petrobras, and 500 billion reais is the debt today. This imbalance came from excessive interventions that were not necessary, based on debts, and the cost was not disclosed to the society. We, as Brazilian people, we were really lenient to let this happen. The National Congress was extremely lenient to let this happen and approve this kind of measures. The last 7 years, the Brazilian society signed blank checks to the government. The government used them all, and today we have fiscal crisis in a hole. A primary deficit in the public sector, 2.2 the GDP, 140 billion reais, and a nominal deficit, 10% of the GDP, 600 billion reais. It's not easy to solve this at all. Brazil will not solve it in a year or 2 year time. This possible government that might start tomorrow has a hard task to try to explicit, to overt to the society all these holes and try to solve it gradually. And Brazil will need to debate, and I see with a great satisfaction this center that McKinsey Institute is creating, because in this country we really need to debate more transparently. Do not be afraid, my best friends. The English people and some American that are really friends of mine, we disagree on many things, but we are friends and we debate here in Brazil. People mix debate of ideas with personal matters. People are afraid of debating. And this cannot happen, because the unique thinking is bad for the society. Back to the fiscal issue, what is the greatest challenge for Brazil? The subnational is the labor. The central government is one thing. Income transfer. The public sector in Brazil, contrary to what we think, there is a lot of regulation and problems, yes. But what has grown more, you can explain. Almost 90% of the public expenditure of the central government, 91 until 2015, income transfer program. What is the government removes from João and transfer to José? And this is social security, unemployment security, family allowance, that is the lowest one, is really small, in a program that we call social assistance, is one minimum wage for elderly and handicapped. We have a system with different problems. I'm going to give a specific example. All countries in the world, when you contribute to the social worker welfare, you receive more than a person who has never contributed. In Brazil, it's the same thing. Imagine a couple. Two people. They have never contributed for welfare. They were always informal. When they reach 65 years old, each one, what is their formal income? Zero. They have never contributed. So each one will have the right of a minimum wage for social assistance and the income for that family, two minimum wages. Imagine the same couple differently. One of them have contributed a lot. All his life he was working in civil construction, and his wife doesn't, never contributed. When they reach 65 years old, he, as a contributor, he has the right to retire in a minimum wage. And the lady, as the family income will be half of the minimum wage, she's not qualified for social assistance. He contributed all his life, the family income will be one minimum wage. If they did not contribute, the family wage would be the double, two minimum wages. This abnormality is happening in Brazil. You need to explain and change. Brazil spends with social policies, health and education, previdence, social security, 25% of GDP. This is about the public expenditure of India, 27% of their GDP. We spend 25% of GDP, and you say that is near Alemanha, Germans, France, Italy. There's nothing wrong, but there is. More than the half of this public expenditure is social security. In a country that is still young and will not be younger 30 years from now, you younger people, I believe myself as well, you are going to get older in a country that we have colleagues to play cards, you know, we can play cards. Exactly because of this, one of the countries that have more elderly is Japan. 30 years from now, Brazil will have exactly the same structure, demographic structure that Japan. Today, Brazil already spends in social security more than Japan. Meaning that we will have to reform Social Security, whether we like it or not, because it's a mathematic need. Otherwise, 30 years from now, Brazil will spend with the Social Security 20% of the GDP. There's no country in the world that spends with Social Security 20% of their GDP. I am 48 years old. Is it fair that I retire 6 years from now when I am 54? Of course not, but the average of retirement age for men is 55 years old. The average for retirement of ladies in Brazil, 54 years old. This is wrong. We have to change it. In the other countries in the world, we establish the minimum retirement age. We have hard decisions to make, but they are necessary. Because simply, it's not possible to grow when we increase public expenditures and taxes. You can tell me the following. There are countries in the world that grew and are developed and they have elevated taxes, different from the US. Germany. Germany has GDP 40 taxes, but there is a difference. Germany increased the taxes throughout years and decades as the worker were more and more productive. A country could elevate the taxes and keep on being competitive. It's not our case. Brazil has taxes excessively high for our level of development. And social policies in the world, they have a term from a Californian professor, Pinkerton III, he calls Robin Hood paradox. The country that spends more in the social matter are rich countries and not poor countries. In order to be wealth, the country to become wealth, the first topic. We do not need an economic miracle. I don't want to see Brazil growing 6-7% a year, because the countries that do this, they do not have sustainable things. For example, China. And now there are two examples worldwide of countries that had a per capita income really similar to ours 2-3 years ago after the war. These countries are developed without any economic miracle. What are these countries? The U.S. and England. The per capita income of the U.S. and England in 1945 was something about $12,000. These countries spent 60 years up to 2007 growing consistently, not 5, not 6% a year, but growing consistently 3-4% a year, per capita income growth 2-3% a year. The secret for a developing country is what the professor said. You need economic freedom, transparency in the expenditures, motivating innovation, entrepreneurship, bringing clear rules. This will take naturally to growth, and it better grow 60 years steadily in the per capita, 2 or 3% a year, rather than one decade growing 5 or 6% per capita, and 2 decades steady. And our history in Brazil, unfortunately, since the 1970s, that's it. 1970s, we reached the growth per capita GDP 6-7% a year, creating imbalances. The government tried what we call a forced walk, make that this growth never stops after 2 oil clashes, and this has taken to a lost decade in the 1980s. The government thought that they could do everything. The second PND, National Plan of Development, is in the origins of our crisis in the 1980s. That was the lost decade. 1990, different countries of Latin America, Brazil, could reform privatization, opening the economy, establishing regulatory agencies connected to the privatization schedule, closed state banks. A modern schedule was fruitful. But then again, 2007, they had this crazy idea, not only Brazil, other Latin American countries, that the government had the power to intervene in economy, and the Latin American Brazil would be great producers for oil, that we would create the oil industry, that we would be the most innovative country in the world, but we needed the intervention from the government, the protection from the government, cheap money for private groups so they can buy their competitors. When you go to the U.S. today and we sit to have dinner, if you get a beer, Brazilian company, possible, meat, if the meat is Swift meat, or chicken, Pilgrim's Pride, Brazilian company. How can the Brazilian companies are there to buy their competitors? Not all of them, yeah? Most of them, public money. It was not necessary. The government, if they do it, it's what the professor said, they are creating a chronic capitalism. Who is closer to the government will have the government as the partner. This is wrong, because if the bakery, John, he cannot do it. And for the capitalism to work, Volkswagen, GM, any company, any Brazilian company, or that is in Brazil, or the bakery around the corner, they need to access the same rules, the same risks, the same benefits that the government. That did not happen in Brazil in the last 7 years. Constantly, we changed the rules, increased the debt, using the public banks to favor private companies, nothing against the private businessmen. They are doing their game, but what takes to growth is not this. Is the competition, education. We expect this from the government, incentives to innovation, clear regulations. And a government does not intervene too much, does not try to do the private sector role. We are talking about a country that, in addition to the elevated taxes, average in Brazil when you pay taxes, 2,600 hours. In Latin America, 340 hours. The legislation has 1,700 pages. Just a crazy person can understand those many pages. I have a company, 100 workers. I have to hire an accounting office because I cannot understand how we pay taxes in Brazil being a businessman. In Brazil, you have the same person, 30,000 reais salary, and this person could be a simple company, could be in another regimen paying more taxes, or could be paying 27%. With the same salary, in the same activities, we have different taxes, so things are complex here. Observing ahead, just to conclude, we need to solve these abnormalities. We need lots of reforms. We have good examples on what to do. Developed countries that could be developed without any economic miracle, without great incentives, the US, England. And more than ever, we need to debate, to have a transparent government and demand from the government. Because if we pay taxes, the government is working for us. And that's it. Thank you. Before starting the debate, I'll give you some time for Professor Benjamin. He would like to say something about the Professor Nosueto's presentation.
Thank you very much for an excellent response reaction. I want to highlight just a couple points that were made by you. I think it was very valuable that you emphasized government spending and the deficits that's going on now, because in the data I was showing about economic freedom, those indexes have a 2-year lag. So that's from 2013 that we last saw. So in all reality, probably Brazil's economic freedom score is lower than what I was showing there, and it's just not going to show up until later this next publishing of the index. A second thing I think is very valuable of what to look for at a model of development is not to look at the United States today and its regulatory policies. When the United States had an income per capita at about the level of Brazil, it had no minimum wage. It had almost no workplace regulations. It barely had an income tax. Going to emulate the Britain and the United States of their era of economic freedom, I think, would be a great success for Brazil rather than looking to their welfare states they have today. Then finally, maybe where we have a little bit more disagreement is I learned somewhere that more is better. And as long as the growth is real and not fake, because some of China's growth is likely fake, I think actually much faster growth than the 3-4% compounding is possible today. And if we look at the post-war world, and I think following the Britain and United States, 3-4% would be fine, but I think more is possible in a sustainable way. When we look at Japan, Taiwan, Hong Kong, Singapore, South Korea in post-war years, they started at about $500 per capita when the United States was at 10,000 and have achieved parity in incomes. And I think as we have a wealthier world with more capital, more technology, the more a country gets their institutions right, the faster sustainable long-term growth one can have now that one couldn't have done in the 19th century when Britain maybe was the first one creating capital and technology anew. So I'm even more optimistic.
Thank you, Professor Benjamin, for your speech. I'll take my position first, and I'll make the first question, but I'll make in Portuguese, if you can put your here, it would be better for the audience.
I would like to ask the first question. I'll be the moderator. And I would like to provoke, to tease you, you young people, these great challenges that we are having ahead of us. The Phi Nobel Prize on Economy was Princeton University, Angus Deaton, and he has a quote saying, "The success generates inequality, but you cannot discourage success." So I would like to get this quote and how we in Brazil, where the main claim, the students, academic, and society is the inequality, how can we get all these benefits that Professor Benjamin brought on economic freedom, this success, this growth, and how can we have this lack of control of public expenses? How can we treat the social matter on the social programs? What about economic freedom? How can it help Brazil in this topic on inequalities? To both.
Okay. I think this is an excellent question, and Deaton is absolutely right. I mean, if we look at the history of humanity, right, we all started equal, but equally poor and dying early. What happened is some countries, starting in the late 1700s, got their institutions right and began growing. There's a wonderful video, if you Google online, the Wealth and Health of Nations video, and it plots all of the data points of every country on Earth being equal back in 1800. And then you see them measuring on one axis health, how long people live, and income on the other. And countries start deviating and moving to the northeast and wealthier, healthier. And this is more unequal, but it's going from everybody being equally dying and poor to some succeeding. What you don't see is the ones who started poor getting poorer because some people went up. In fact, quite the opposite. Because the technology that's innovated by the countries that are successfully growing, not only do you have countries that later emulate and grow faster to catch up, but you also see them all moving up, becoming healthier, life expectancy is going up as the technology and the growth is transferred to those who even haven't got their institutions right. So I think it does create more our greatest inequality, of course, is between countries. I think this concern of inequality within countries is just vastly overrated compared to that. But the final point related to this and economic freedom, I think we have to be careful about giving up the word equality and saying that there's going to be a trade-off with this, because there's two types of equality that matter, or there's two types of equality. One type, I think, matters much more than the other. There's equality of outcome, which is what most of the leftists want to talk about. But there's equality of treatment, which is what I think true liberals and free market people should care about. We should treat everybody equally in giving them great degrees of economic freedom, not regulating some and not others, not benefiting some businesses against others. That's unequal treatment. And then whatever outcomes people decide, people have different abilities, different preferences. Any system that treats everybody equally is necessarily going to have unequal outcomes. But your alternative of getting some measured equal outcomes is a tyranny where nobody is treated equally, and everybody is treated differently.
I think that's it. There are two things, for example, inequalities, good and bad inequalities. For example, there is good and bad cholesterol. Inequalities is natural on results, outcomes, is normal and is good. And what I mean is people do not want to be equal. There are people that want to retire, do not work very early. Others, I have a customer, he's 77 years old, he's wealthy, and he wants to retire at 84. So there are people who work on weekends. There are people that just work from Monday to Thursday. People don't want to be treated equally. They go to the financial market. They are going to be really stressed because they want to make more money. Other people want to work in a nice activity. People do not want to be equal. So the outcome of the work by nature will be unequal, and that's not bad. The other inequality is bad. What is? What we call equal opportunities. I think that the objective of any society is the following. Regardless the family you were born with and the place, geographical place that you were born, if it's here in Jundiaí, Campinas, or Caucaia in the interior of Ceará, that child needs to access good school and health. And this, everybody's equal in the growth process and competition process. So it's really hard to achieve this, but all the countries in the world seek their children, regardless their place, birth, and their family, what we called equal opportunities to access good education, to reach nutrition, eat, and health. This kind of equality on opportunities is wish. The state should seek this and provide this. The result of work, the inequality on income, at some point is positive, is beneficial. So you try to have everyone with similar income is wrong, because people choose different lives, and what the state should incentivize is equality on opportunities. Unfortunately, although Brazil has a social expense really high, in fact, we try to solve a problem on outcome, then solve the beginning of the problem, that is basic schools that are really bad, unequal throughout the Brazilian territory. In Brazil today, the success of a child really depends on the family they are born with and the geographical site. The government should be concerned about it, but countries like Brazil and India, they did, before investing in basic education, they invested in higher education, public higher education. This is an abnormality. For the last 15, 20 years, we are trying to correct this, but up to now in Brazil, we spend per student in a public university much more, five times more than the government spends per student in basic education. In other countries in the world, this is the same. or basic education, you spend more. This we are trying to correct. We are really far away from that. But a society, the government should act and concern to provide equality of opportunities. And what comes from that? The inequality coming from that on income, different choices that we do in our professions is beneficial. This is fruit of capitalism. This will motivate people to work more and take risks. And if you take risks, to have financial gains. And this is beneficial.
Nós temos várias perguntas, algumas já foram.
There are lots of questions and we filtered some, but because of the time, we only have two questions more. I'm so sorry, and then if possible, we'll address your questions to answers to all the participants. There are interesting questions about the car wash scheme in Brazil, a really good one, but we do not have time for that. Professor Mansueto, but also if Professor Benjamin would like to participate, Thiago Lopes de Souza. In order to increase the economic freedom in Brazil, it would be necessary to privatize public sectors to decrease the taxes. But in a fiscal crisis that we experience, how would it be possible to do it short term? What kind of public companies would you see proper to be privatized? Privatize. In some states that we have public companies, we could privatize. Federal, we have Caixa Econômica Federal, different companies connected to the bank. Caixa Econômica Insurance Company could be privatized. You have some companies, Petrobras Group, BR Distributors, Transpetro. They can be privatized without any problem. So you have a great number of companies that could be privatized in Brazil. I do not see any problem. I'm not interested if the government produces oil efficiently. What interests me if this public sector provides public health and public education, basic education, efficiently, and of course, and has all these state instruments to regulate legal security that works efficiently. If the government produces more or less, this does not interest. The discussion of the left wing in the 1940s was about the government ability to produce. This was 1940. This is over. The state does not have to own companies that could be in the private sector. I don't want that the state produce products. I want the state providing what is expected, public security, health, and public education that is quality, as in other countries. About the taxes, unfortunately, three times. The taxes in Brazil will not be reduced. There is no room to reduce the taxes after the 7 years, increasing the debt to provide incentives and the real expenses growing over the GDP, 6-7% a year, almost the double of the GDP. All the countries in the world that this happens, the result is you have to increase taxes or cut expenses to pay the bill. Cut expenses, okay. We cut expenses, okay. Nobody wants to do that. When you put everyone in favor of fiscal adjustment, you have to sit around the table and detail the programs. We cut last year. The highest source was public investments dropped, and the central government 34%, in the states 50%. You cannot do the same this year. We need to cut expenses, yes we do, but we are not going to make fool of ourselves. We have 120 billion whole in order to reach 2018 and stop the debt. I need a fiscal effort. A deficit, I have to produce surplus, 4 points in the GDP. In 2 years, we have a fiscal adjustment, 240 billions in 2 years. Is it possible for the country to cut 240 billions in 2 years? I'll clearly say it's impossible. It is impossible. The fiscal adjustment that will start in this new government that may start tomorrow, it will still be the same in 2019. The only way to reduce the taxes is if we control the public expenses. But for the next 3-4 years, there is no room to reduce the taxes. And we have to pray to not see increase of taxes. So we can simplify the taxes. It's not meaningful to have an elevated number of taxes and high bureaucracy to pay. If you reduce the complexity of taxes, of course, the fiscal lawyers will lose their job. That's a good thing. But this will take to an increase of efficiency. Reducing the taxes, unfortunately, there's no room. Simplifying the taxes, maybe. You know, my conclusion as a debater, I have the joy and the sadness, you know. But I'll try to brief, to give opportunities to you. I try to gather three questions in one question. That is the final question. And if the debaters would like, at the end, you can have your final considerations on your participation at this roundtable. So the question is, Mariana Macedo, Thiago Jucá, and Aziz Najjar. And the question is, what is the measure or what are the measures that Brazil should take to implement or stimulate entrepreneurship, to increase economic freedom, and to change this culture that we have today in Brazil, to change the culture of our economic thinking?
Yes, the last question.
All right. I think that this is very important. I think all sorts of areas of economic freedom, all would be good to increase here. I think regulatory burdens and taxation and spending are key. And I am an academic, so I don't worry about what is politically possible. I worry about speaking what I think of as truth and worrying about other people to figure out if they can make it politically possible. So I am a radical abolitionist. An abolitionist of state intervention into the economy. So in response to the other question of what state industries could be privatized, I say you should do all of them. You had a nice list and it was a good start. And some people will respond, well, some of these will not survive if they are privatized. And to that I would say, good riddance. You shouldn't have been there in the first place then. In terms of the spending and taxation, I think it's absolutely crucial of cutting the government spending, and that can involve privatizing existing state businesses. But I won't speak specifically to the Brazilian situation of your trade-offs between these things in the short run, as I don't study it. But I look at the United States and where the United States is headed and its fiscal trajectory, and we too are running up. I shouldn't say we too. I personally am not running up debt. The government of the United States, who rules over me, is running up unsustainable debt. And the economic forecast of the size of this, if you count our retirement system and our Medicaid system, is over $200 trillion. That's simply not ever going to be paid. The United States government is going to do some combination of defaulting on its obligations, both to bondholders and to entitlement holders. And I think that for radical free market types, when you look at a government that's racked up unsustainable debt, sometimes I think we should just call it what it is bad debt that's unsustainable. Repudiate it, say you're not paying it back, wipe the slate clean, but then reduce spending and lower taxes for everybody else then. And yes, it'll make it harder to borrow in the future, but I think of that as kind of a balanced budget amendment with teeth. It makes it harder for them to be irresponsible again. And on an ethical side, it's, you know, people who took a financial risk lending to a government, that doesn't privilege them to never having any losses. Just like any other bondholder, when you invest in a business, you have some sort of default risk. And it should apply to those who lend to a government, particularly an irresponsible government, too. So I think that's partially addressing this new question and also a little bit of the last. As for getting the culture right, I think nobody's got a roadmap for social change that does this. I think education, particularly among young people and students, is absolutely crucial. And I think what you're doing here at McKenzie to promote the discussion, the free discussion of these ideas and challenge the status quo is an absolutely essential ingredient for that process. Best of luck with it. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Cultural change takes time. For example, the Asian countries that grow very fast, Japan, Korea, Taiwan, these countries, the savings is really high. People save money. The total savings of the country is 30-35% of the GDP. What about Brazilian savings? 16% of the GDP, 16%. This country will never have the power of growth from the Asian country. People in Brazil and Latin America, it's not the case of people that are here. But see the result of our elections for the last 14 years. People voted for interventionist candidates. This new potential president for tomorrow says that he's going to close the trading ministry. Who got revolted? The elite of our country, our friends, the elite of our country. I could name a few of them. These people got revolted. Brazil needs the trade ministry. Why? Why do we need industry and trade ministry? We do not. One thing is what we think. Another thing is that the great majority of Brazilian people from low income or high income Brazilian, they love the state. They lobby the state. I could name cases that I experienced negotiating with big companies that we admire, going to the Congress with amendment to give to congressmen favoring specific companies with lawyers, 10 lawyers well-dressed, taking the amendment. I know exactly the name of these people and the name of the companies. Unfortunately, in this country, not only in Brazil, Latin America as a whole, we like the state. This is, we do not change overnight. There is a center to foster debates and a freedom as McKenzie Center. This is spectacular. This is spectacular because we have an idea. A lot of people in Brazil, not because they are bad, because they do not have education, they don't have studies, they have a wrong idea of development. Development comes with a bigger state and incentivizing the investment. This is the recipe for the disaster. The developer comes with clear rules, stable entrepreneurship, quality education, quality health, and trade openness. This agenda people see as negative, putting liberal as something bad. In fact, is a sustainable growth agenda. And this is what I wish for our country. This will take time, but that's the way.
I
would like to thank Professor Benjamin, Professor Mansueto, and now the microphone is to the ceremonial, and we are about to finish. Just we have a gift in our ceremonial. We would like to invite Professor Benedito and the advisor José Inácio Ramos to hand in an institution gift to Professor Powell and to the economist Mansueto de Almeida.
We
would like to thank the presence of you, the relevant contributions, Dr. Cabrera as a mediator. And this is just the beginning. The reality, we need to be aware of reality. We cannot lose the optimism. And I believe that the Economic Freedom Center at McKinsey will bring, will show us the light at the end of the tunnel. Thank you so much.